17.
The finest. As life goes on, you learn to hold on. You learn to appreciate the finer things in life. The finest. We'll be right back.
Welcome to the third program of ARTrepreneurship Workshop. This is series number 3. We are so happy that you could be a part of this event. We want to thank our sponsors, our supporters, and of course, you, our audience, and encourage you to continue to follow us on this journey of ARTrepreneurship. Today, we're going to talk with Delita Martin, as I still call her by her old name. Sorry about that.
That's Delita. Okay.
But we do want to talk with her about her experiences as a beginning artist, those roads she took to understanding what it takes not only to be a creative artist, but an artist who knows how to represent herself and to understand the art market. Delita, it's so nice to have you with us today.
Thank you so much for coming to the studio. Welcome, welcome. Thank you. So I'm so excited to be able to share what I know, you know, with the audience and with everyone here today. So I'm really excited about this.
So tell us a little bit about your beginning as an artist.
Wow. So I've been drawing all my life. It started off with coloring books, and I was really fascinated with coloring books. So every week I would get at least 2 new coloring books. I would go through them very, very quickly. And so I was always encouraged to create. My father was, you know, an artist as well. And so he encouraged me to create and make things. And so most of the people in my family, they were writers, they are quilt makers, they're poets, just really almost existing in an art colony, an art community. So creativity was just something that we did all the time. So at 5, I think I was around 5 years old, kindergarten, I decided I was going to be an artist. Had no clue what that meant, or, you know, the path, the journey that would take me on. But I decided I was going to be an artist. My parents reinforced it. They would introduce me to people and they would say, this is our baby. This is our baby daughter. And she's an artist. So it just kind of reinforced what I said I was going to do. And the journey began at that point.
That's quite interesting. And especially for young parents with children. And they say at 5, you're a little young to know what you want to do. However, environment is important and exposure is important. So that's something that I've gleaned from what you had to say. But how did you continue that journey? Because people do change their minds.
You know, it was never a question as to where I was going to go to school. I always knew I was going to go to school at TSU. I wanted to study with Dr. Biggers. I was a little late for that, but it was just, that's where I was going to go. I was going to major in art, and it was just something I continued to do. And again, it was there was never a plan B. So any opportunity that I got to participate in art shows, I did. I knew what I wanted in the end eventually, but I just wasn't quite sure the path that I would need to take to get there. So it was just remaining focused on the goal of being an artist, maintaining my own studio, being able to show around the world. That's what I wanted for myself. So taking those necessary steps to do that. And as artists, you know, we don't have a set path. There's no, you know, you go to school for 4 years, you know, you take an internship here. It doesn't work exactly the same way for every artist. So I wasn't sure what that looked like. So I'm always happy to share my experiences with other artists, you know, who are new or just, you know, have questions in general navigating a particular space, because there's not a set path for us.
Well, that's really interesting that you did continue on your path as an artist, I'm supposing, all the way through high school.
Yes.
And then on to Texas Southern University, which was a great choice, I might add.
Of course. I had wonderful teachers.
Well, wonderful that you did go in that direction and you didn't let yourself be deterred. Now, sometimes people don't take that path. Right. Sometimes they don't go to college. They're self-taught. Mm-hmm. Or they have a mentor who grooms them, mm-hmm. and but they still want to succeed as an artist. Yeah. Was the career or the teachings and experiences you had enough to move you on? Or were there some other things that you had to do to move yourself beyond a graduate with an art degree and a person now who's beginning a career as an artist?
Yes, definitely having the support system in school, having a support system at home and around you, you know, people to support your creative outlets, your creative activities, you know, having those people are wonderful. But I feel like that you have to know yourself. I always tell people, decide what type of artist you want to be, not the artist that someone else wants you to be. Yes. So if you are interested in graphic design, that's fine. If you're interested in, you know, being a figurative artist, that's fine. You have to decide and you have to be happy with it. From there, you have to find your tribe, find your circle. Find the people who are successfully doing what you want to do and study them, you know, figure out what's happening in your community that you can be a part of, involved in, and know what's happening around you in the arts. And that's very important. And then you have to be okay with it. And at the very last, give yourself permission to be that artist. We don't give ourselves permission. You know, we get caught up in life. We get caught up in things that are happening around us. And, you know, your path may get deterred. You know, your direction may change, but always set your compass to get you back to where you want to be. Because life happens.
Life does happen. So you said something that I found very interesting. Mm-hmm. Find your niche, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Study from others. Mm-hmm. So did you go to galleries? Did you meet artists? How did you build that network?
All of that. Volunteering to do things in the art community. Becoming friends with artists, you know, putting yourself out there, introducing yourself to artists, going to exhibitions, going to every city that I would go to, I would find where the artists are. You know, where's the art community, introducing yourself to the university. I remember moving to Little Rock and the first thing I did was found the art department on campus and introduce myself to the chair. So it's just really important to put yourself out there, to seek the knowledge that you want to learn, because it's not always going to come and sit in your lap. So that means going to exhibitions, reading about art all the time, yes. Going online, searching out exhibitions, searching out artists who are doing what you're doing. I mean, there have been tons of Google searches that I've done, African-American female printmakers, mixed media printmaking artists. I mean, there's a list of things that I Google and I learn about new artists and new processes every single day.
Once you learn about these artists, once you at least find where you want to go as an artist, mm-hmm. then what do you do to begin to establish yourself now as an artist? Because it takes some unique steps, doesn't it?
It does. exhibition records are very important. You know, going online, and I can't remember exactly the name of the website, but there's a website that lists exhibitions for artists to participate in. And that's a really good way to build an exhibition foundation. And you know, when you put your resume out there and you're applying for exhibitions or applying for other opportunities, you know, people are looking, where have you exhibited? Where have you seen? And so that's a really, I found it a really good way to build up your exhibition experience. So that's the next step, I think, in being in the studio and creating the work. So I encourage artists to always at least take an hour out of your day to be in a creative space. So that may mean you're reading about art. It doesn't necessarily mean that you're producing, but you're in an environment where you are absorbing art, creativity, whether you're looking at other artists' work, whether you're reading about other artists, whether you're reading, researching on a particular subject or a particular process, at least spend an hour a day doing that.
So we talk about the track record now. You're establishing yourself at least with exhibitions. Mm-hmm. And we all know it's not easy all the time to establish yourself with exhibitions. Mm-hmm. Some galleries charge a fee for you to participate. Some want you to have a certain number of works to participate. And so you have to find a way to do this.
Yes.
And then there's another thing I'd like for you to share with the audience here. How do you price your work when you're getting started? How do you know how to price your work when you're getting started?
Yeah, pricing work was extremely difficult. But to answer your first question, in terms of the types of exhibitions, there are a lot of free exhibitions out there. There are a lot of opportunities to apply for, let's say, residencies or mini residencies that offer exhibitions as an opportunity. And then also, we as artists, I mean, right now we're living in a time where we are our own resources as well. So, I mean, there are pop-up shows that happen. I mean, why not find a space, a coffee shop near you that you, you know, you connect with, become good friends with, and let's say, or a salon. I mean, there's 100 different ways to present your work. You know, inviting the right people, inviting, you know, maybe there's a gallerist that, you know, you're interested in. Hey, I'm having a salon. Come see my work. So there's all different things that you can do to promote yourself and get your work out there. In terms of pricing work, there's so many different formulas out there. I personally, when I price my work, I look at the amount of work that I put into it, the amount of hours that I put into it. Of course, size is a consideration as well. The material, I always try and use the best material. So all of those things go into consideration in pricing. Also, your exhibition record, again, plays another part. What collections you're a part of, that plays a part in pricing. The more collection, museum collections that you're involved in, the more, you know, institutions that collect your work, you know, that just propels you to a different level. And you keep building and building and building on that.
We know that sometimes artists can price themselves out of the market before they start. So it is good to do some research.
Yes.
To know yourself, to know the market as well, and to make sure you at least start, I guess, with your work in the hands of some collectors. That gets you going.
Yes.
If you can, and with the exhibition record as well. That's all really good news.
And you know, there's so many gallerists, art educators, curators that are willing to sit down and talk to artists about work, about pricing work, and all of the other behind the scenes things. So I think that we have to be a resource for each other. In anybody in the art community, you know, if you have knowledge, to be able to share that knowledge is, you know, I call people all the time. You know, my friends who are curators, you know, I'll call and ask a curatorial question or, you know, what's the proper way to do X, Y, Z. And they've always been there for me. And, you know, which is, again, what I try and do for other artists. So, you know, if you're having questions about, you know, what you should be requesting in terms of exhibitions, because, you know, not every artist, you know, is on the same level. You know, some artists can ask for a little bit more than other artists. Well, talk to a curatorial friend and say, hey, this is where I am. You know, check out my resume. You know, is this acceptable? Or is it acceptable that I ask for XYZ? So,
all that's really good news for the beginning artist to consider. You mentioned one other thing that I thought was very important. You talked about the materials. And I think along with that, we need to consider the craftsmanship. Content is important.
Yes.
What your message is certainly important. But people want to know, if I'm purchasing this work, will it last on the materials?
Yes, sustainability.
Yes. So
I am very adamant about using materials that are sustainable. I use all archival materials. So that's very important.
Explain that to our audience.
So when I talk about archival materials, you know, is this paper going to change color over time? Is the adhesive that I use going to cause the paper to yellow or brittle or something along those lines? What's the quality of paper that I'm using? And I always make sure that I'm using the best in those in those areas, because it's very important. You know, you're investing in work. You want it to be around for a long time. And as an artist, you know, you put your heart and soul into this piece. You want it to be around 100 years from now. And you want people to be able to come and see the work. So sustainability is very important.
And that information, a lot of times today, is available online, as well as you can just ask.
Yeah, research, you know, again, researching, talking to other artists who are working in the same field, or even talking to artists who don't. I mean, I found out, you know, I use adhesives in my work that are used by bookbinders. Because bookbinders, their books are around a long time. So even if it's talking to artists who work in different mediums, that can always be helpful. So I always put myself or look upon myself as being an artist who can always learn. I'm always open to learning something new to improve upon what I'm doing already.
Well, let's just say a young artist has gone through those stages. They prepared themselves in terms of understanding the market. They prepared themselves in understanding the kind of materials that are sustainable. And they've had some exhibitions. So how do you move on to that next level of the professional artist where people are calling on you because you have established yourself?
Representation. Finding a gallery that fits you. Okay. Finding a gallery that works for you. And I think what took me by surprise was that there are different levels of galleries. There are different types of galleries. You know, there are galleries where you go in and the work's hanging there. You buy it or you don't. Mm-hmm. There's galleries that, you know, work for the artists, that are calling you up saying, hey, you know, I have an opportunity for you. There's galleries that's calling clients, introducing your work to new clients, that's constantly working on your behalf. So you have to decide, you know, what type of gallery representation you would like. And when you talk to a gallery, go into a gallery and look, just kind of look before you even approach them to see if, you know, if you feel like this gallery is a good fit. You want to make sure the work, you know, that they carry. I always look to see the quality of artists that a gallery has. Okay. You know, that's important to me. I want to be among the best. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you have artists that aren't, you know, that don't care about craftsmanship or, you know, other things, then maybe you're not the gallery to represent me. So they're all different types, but I want artists to understand also, you are just as important in that relationship as the gallery is. So make sure that not only are you being interviewed, but make sure you're interviewing as well. So because you want to make sure that they're a good fit for you and you're a good fit for them.
I've heard many artists say that I just make the work. I can't sell it. They want, you know, somebody else to do it for them. So what relationship are we talking about in that sense? And one other question too, while we're at it, galleries do differ in the amount of time that they require on a contract. Mm-hmm. It is a contractual relationship. Talk about that a little bit.
You know, again, what I'm finding is that every artist contract, they vary. Okay. You could have 10 people with the same gallery and they may all have totally different contracts.
Right.
So it's important for artists to understand what their rights are. Okay. Again, understand what your role is and what your relationship is going to be with this particular gallery. And if it works for you, then it works for you. And I think that's important for the artist to understand what they want. So, and I think you're able, once you figure out what kind of artist you want to be, it makes it easier to figure out what type of representation you want to have, what kind of partners you want to have coming in your corner. So that's important.
So that brings me to another question. You're now a professional artist, probably have a contract with at least a gallery.
Mm-hmm.
And I know some galleries don't allow you to have other contracts, mm-hmm. and some galleries do allow you to have, as long as they're within a certain distance.
Correct.
And you can make those considerations. But now comes the pressure. Right?
Right.
You have to produce.
Correct. So again, making sure you have an understanding with your gallery of how you in that gallery is going to work. Again, you know, you have people with the same gallery and they work totally different together. Mm-hmm. But artists also, you can't wait for inspiration to hit. You have to be in the studio and you have to be producing the work. Yes. And by spending time with creativity or within your creativity, creative space, it becomes easier and easier to come into the studio and work. And so you just have to be prepared to get the work done. You can't wait for to be hit over the head with some inspiration. It doesn't work that way.
Right. It becomes your full-time job.
It becomes a full-time job. Yes.
Whatever clock you put it on, but it's your full-time job.
You know, you get to step, you know, the one thing I love about being an artist is I was able to come into my space and figure out how I wanted it to work for me. Mm-hmm. I spent a full year figuring out what my hours would look like. I mean, I tried combinations of let me see working in the evening, maybe working in the morning, maybe Wednesdays are administrative days, maybe not. So I tried all different combinations, formulas for how I would create this, you know, have this work as a job. And so I finally figured it out. I'm still tweaking it. But, you know, I'm able to set how set the structure for my studio. And I think you just have to do it and you have to be committed enough to get up and go to work every day.
So we're working with a gallery. We're working with a representative.
Yes.
And how do you continue that relationship while producing your work? What does it take from that point on to become really successful at what you're going to do?
Really, it's really about getting the work done, like making the commitment to create the work and partnering with, I mean, I think about my gallery. I've been with my galleries for years. I'm with Stella Jones Gallery in New Orleans and Gallery Mertisse in Baltimore, Maryland. And I've been with them for years because we have a working relationship. We have a partnership and we figured out what our partnership is. And they're two amazing, wonderful galleries. They allow me the space to create the work I need to create in the time frame that I need to create it in. And I make sure that they have what they need when they need it. So, you know, their deadlines that I have to meet. It's not, you know, totally just willy-nilly get in the studio, do what you want to do. There are deadlines, there's administrative part to the job. It's a functioning job.
So they talk with you regularly. They want to look at your work. You know, sometimes artists don't want you to look at their work. You want to.
No, I'm totally open to that, which is really, it's interesting for me because typically, you know, I'll create a body of work and I'm not always able to shift it to the next project. You know, it's not available anymore. And so, you know, I will occasionally talk to my gallery, hey, you know, this is the work that's available. Or if there's something, if there's a goal that I want to achieve, which is what I really love about both galleries, is that I can call them up and say, hey, you know, I was thinking about, you know, XYZ for my next project. And I was thinking about, you know, this is where I want my career to go. And they are both open and say, hey, okay, well, let's talk about this. Let's figure out how we can come together and make this happen. And that's what I wanted in a gallery, was I wanted a partnership and I wanted someone that was going to help me to grow my career. And so that's the gallery I was looking for.
So it's interesting that your galleries are both out of state. Yes. And in different states. Mm-hmm. And so you do have to communicate with them. Mm-hmm. How did you locate, how did you pick them as gallery representatives, and how do you work as far as your local community?
They called me, which okay. was great. And of course, through the artist network, I spoke with other artists who had worked with them. Mm-hmm. And
just raving reviews. Everybody thought they were wonderful. I was like, you know, maybe this is a good fit for me. Let's try. So after talking with them, explaining to them where I wanted my career to go, what were some of the goals and objectives that I had for my career, they were totally supportive and said the magic words of, what can we do to help you get there, which was very important for me. And that's the path that we've been on since, I guess, for like the last 6 years. It's been incredible. You know, I'll call and say, hey, you know, I think I want to have an exhibition next year. Okay, well, let's see if we can make that happen. Is there a particular place you wanted to have the exhibition? What is the exhibition going to be about? So all those things are discussed, but, you know, I feel like I have a team that's, you know, willing to step in and do what needs to get done for my career to go to the next level.
So you mentioned the team. So you have a manager, administrator. How do you make it work? I mean,
I have an administrative assistant who is incredible, absolutely amazing. So she handles all of my scheduling, any exhibition dates, flights, anything administrative. She works that out for me. In terms of physical help in the studio, I bring in help on a project basis only, just because that's how I work as an artist. You know, some artists have full-time studio assistants. I find that I work better on a project basis. I love, I guess, kind of being alone in the studio. And I work with my husband as well. Mm-hmm. He's pretty much everything in fine print. he wears a lot of different hats. Which is great. So I do have a small team. It would be very difficult to do that without them. But it was something that I had to grow into also. So it wasn't something that I started off with. Mm-hmm. But as my career has grown, it calls for new structures in the way the studio is set up. And so I've had, I want to say for like the last maybe 2 years, 2.5 years, I've had an administrative assistant, which has been phenomenal.
Okay. And you pay that
person
yourself to work.
I pay that person myself.
And stay in contact with them. Mm-hmm. For the young artist, emerging artist, who wants to get to your level, maybe not there yet, what skills are needed to help propel you to that point where you are able now not only to make a career and to support yourself and your family from your art, but also it's a business, isn't it?
Yes.
You support others. Yes. Tell us.
So I had to learn the business side of art really, really fast.
Okay.
And so it was, how do you price your work came first. And that was really scary because I didn't want to underprice myself and I didn't want to price myself out of the market. So that took a while. But, you know, we talked about all the things I consider when doing that. It's important for artists to know how to talk about their work.
Yes.
And so I'm always, you know, I don't have a problem giving interviews about my work because no one knows my work better than me. Yes. And so I always tell artists, you know your work, know how to talk about your work. No one knows your work except for you. So that's extremely important to know how to do. And I switch hats all day. There's a little bit of administrative stuff I do. I'm the person in the mail room. I'm the person producing the work. You know, I'm the first person to screen any project that comes into the studio or any exhibition that happens. And then it's disseminated onto my team where they look at dates and the details. So I built a really great system in that way. You know, projects come in, hey, Delita, this came through. Are you interested in this project? Yes, I'm interested. Set up a meeting or find out the details for me. So I'm still able to be here and create, but I have a team that's amazing that I trust and, you know, we get it done.
Trust, that's an important word.
Trust is a very important word because at the end of the day, you know, this is your name. This is your vision, your name, and it's important to have people in place to that are supportive, people that you trust, people that you can hand things off to, because, you know, it's your baby, you know?
So I'm going to bring up another question, and we're going to talk about your work mm-hmm. real quickly. You mentioned communication.
Yes.
That's more than just talking about your art. Mm-hmm. When things are written.
Yes.
What happens?
That is extremely important to be able to talk about your work and write about your work, because you're going to be writing artist statements and statements about your work mm-hmm. every day, all day, impromptu, just whatever. Okay. And it's really important. So I work on a new body of work, and at some point I'll stop and I'll write about it.
Okay.
Just in general, just for myself. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I have those notes that I can refer to, you know, things that I can just, that I have, but I'm constantly reading and writing and talking about my work.
Excellent. Excellent. So let's talk about your work now. I'd love to hear about the work that you do as a printmaker. Certainly, and it's taken you in many, many directions. So let's tell me a little bit about.
So I started off just kind of like, well, I was at the university and I was working adjunct, and then I decided that I was going to go into the studio full time. And it was really difficult, because I was like, how do I turn something that I love into a job? And how is this going to, you know, how is this going to work out? What's going to happen? And so I had to figure that out. So it took me about a year and a half to eventually get into what I call a rhythm or a flow. And then I had to figure out, I had to figure out how to get that to work as a job. So I did.
Right. So let me just think about a few things that I've just heard you talk about. It's important to communicate. It's important to be able to write about your art. It's important to do that research.
Yeah.
All those things are extremely important as an artist. It's important to build a network of people you trust, who know your work, who know you, and can give you the best advice to help you move along your journey. And it takes a while. You're not going to get there immediately.
Oh, no.
You got to be willing to put yourself through the test, through the trials, to persevere,
mm-hmm.
regardless what happens, the ups and downs, and you'll make it, and you'll make it. So now we are talking about you mm-hmm. as this successful artist who has a printmaking studio.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that aspect of your work now that you've arrived as an artist who's making it and working, doing the thing that wakes you up every morning, keeps you excited.
Well, it's exciting. I get to wake up every morning, like you said, and do something that I really love. It keeps me busy. It keeps me on my toes. Like I said, I wear all the hats in here. You know, I'm the person in the mailroom. I'm the creative artist. I'm that person that's driving the new project directions in the studio. So when I first came in the studio, and I was like, you know, I really want to challenge myself in terms of the type of work that I'm creating, and you know, thinking about how do I want to be seen out in the world, you know, what type of artist do I want to be known as? And my background was drawing at Texas Southern University, and go to Purdue, and I decided I want to do printmaking.
Right.
And so I had to decide how, you know, I had to tell myself every single day in the studio, you can create whatever you want to create. This is your world. You're inviting the viewer in. What do you want to do? And so I began to layer the different printmaking processes with drawing, layering with painting, layering silkscreen on top of relief, on top of etchings, on top of lithography. And it was the first time that I felt free as an artist, as a creative person. And I felt very comfortable in that skin. But At first it was a little awkward, you know, I felt comfortable in the studio doing that, but I was like, I was afraid of what people would say when I, you know, put the work out into the world. And then it became just not important. It became about being a creative person and giving myself permission to be the type of artist that I was meant to be.
You're working in a printmaking world now.
Yes.
And you are able to give yourself permission mm-hmm. to carry your prints much further. Some people don't really understand even the basics of printmaking, but why printmaking? I know you majored in it.
So I never shared this story with you. Texas Southern University, I think it was a weekend, and I came back to the building to pick up some supplies for drawing. Dr. Biggers, Harvey Johnson, and Charles Kreiner were in the printmaking room. Okay. And Dr. Biggers was reopening an edition, lithograph. And I walked in. And it was just incredible to see. It was almost like a dance to see them, you know, wipe the stone and roll and wipe and, you know, the processing of the stone itself. And Dr. Biggers was sitting there signing prints. And I just sat on a stool very quietly thinking to myself, I'm going to learn this. I want to learn this process. This is incredible. And it wasn't until years later. And I was just like, I'm going to go to school for printmaking. And it was really weird because I did not have that background in printmaking. But it made sense to me. It was the next step. I look at printmaking as drawing. It's the same thing for me. It's, you know, I switch out my pencil for a carving knife or a litho crayon, or, you know, my surface is no longer paper. It's a stone, or it's a metal plate, or it's a wood plate, you know? So that was, but it was still the same. Mm-hmm. And so I had to learn how to translate my drawings into printmaking, which was a challenge within itself. Mm-hmm. But I felt excited. I was reinvigorated with art again. And I was like, okay, I'm gonna do this. And then once I left the university, went into the studio, I was like, how can I take this further? And it was like, the further I pushed the printmaking and the drawing and combining them and bringing in the stitching, it all made sense.
So there's so many printmaking techniques. Mm-hmm. And we talked about pricing your work and moving it to different levels. For the young entrepreneur who wants to engage in printmaking, mm-hmm. which techniques should they, well, we'll just say looking at those techniques and how you might, an audience might receive them. How do you, you know, I do know that they come in editions.
Right.
And what's different between that and say an original painting or a drawing, and what mm-hmm. people are willing to pay for it. And how do you move it to the point where that print, which can be in multiple editions, mm-hmm. it's now and looked at each one as an original. Talk to us a little bit about that.
Well,
process.
Printmaking within itself, each print is a unique impression. So each piece is individually done. You know, it's not, they're not exact.
Okay.
You know, to the naked eye, perhaps, but they're just not exact. So each one is a unique impression. I work in small editions. Okay. They're always or primarily varied editions because I like for everything to be different. So when I go back into a print and I do the handwork, it's always different. I use different, layer it with different papers, but the base of the image is always the same. So, you know, there's so much you could do within the area of printmaking. I mean, so many different processes that you can do. And I mean, I love them all. Yeah. I love to layer them all.
Yeah. Could you mention just a few of those techniques?
So the first technique that I learned that I fell in love with was relief printing.
All right.
The carving the block. And grad school, they encourage you to just go crazy, do anything, everything you can. And I fell in love with relief printing. I think the first actual process that I did was gelatin printing. And I did that because we had a critique coming up. I was broke and I didn't have any materials. And I made my gelatin plate using gelatin from a box in the store. I bought a book on how to make the plates, and I kind of toyed around with that for a little while, which became a big part of what I do. So, I mean, you can take some very simple processes and make them as, you know, sophisticated as you need them to be, or as simple as you need them to be, either way. But yeah, just lithography, etching, just all of those different processes. I love those. And I like, and people always say, well, what's your favorite process? I'm like, whatever I'm working on that week is my favorite.
And so for the young artist that says, I really want to explore, I'm a painter maybe, or I like drawing as Delita does. And I might want to explore some of these printmaking techniques. They can certainly find out the description of those techniques, and some are monoprints. They start.
Yeah, some are monoprints. You can, lithography, there's several different techniques within lithography. I know that print, you know, a lot of people that start, because one of my fears when I left graduate school is that I wasn't going to have access to a press anymore. Right. Well, there's processes that you can do that don't require a press. There's gelatin printing. There's relief printing by hand. There's paper lithography. There's so many different printing processes that may seem, you know, low tech, and you don't, you know, need a lot of chemicals, or you don't need any chemicals at all, and you can print them by hand. And so that's literally what I started off doing after graduate school, because I didn't have access to a press. And then eventually I got my first press and went from there. But where there's a will, there's always a way. It just takes a little research.
Wonderful, wonderful. So from your original, I know your early works are mostly just black and white works, and you've moved into color.
Yes.
And I mean, the color palette has exploded with your neutral tones as well. Talk about that impact. How did that impact you? And when did you branch
out? I have always loved color. I've always loved texture and patterns, and just all of that is like so wonderful to me. Around fourth grade, my teacher told me I was using color incorrectly. And she never explained to me what that meant. And so, you know, being fourth grader, I shied away from color. So all of my drawings became black and white drawings. And it wasn't until I got to graduate school and we were encouraged to explore that I said, you know what, I'm going to explore color again. Okay. And so I started off with monochromatic colors. And then I was just like, you know what, I'm just going to go for it. I'm just going to do it. And I did. And I enjoyed it. And I loved it. And I was like, let me keep going with this. This is great. So, yeah.
Tell us a little bit about your process now, how you work.
I like to work very intuitively. So I do not work from a sketchbook. I do not work from sketches at all. I come into the studio. I'll have a vague idea of what I want to do, but nothing set in stone, nothing set in concrete. And I'll come in and I'll just start with a background, or what I call the veilscape in my work. And that's the first layer that's created. Once that layer is created, the portrait comes next. And from there, there's a push and pull that happens between the mediums. So, you know, from there, it could be painting, it could be drawing, it could be printing, it could be collage, it could be any number of things take place, because each layer kind of determines what happens in the next layer of the work. And so I always try and leave room for change to happen. So I don't ever like to come into the studio with concrete ideas.
I love that. I love that. So you start with your work, and once you've created a work, I know that you do variations on that theme, and that creates your body of work for you. And when you're looking at how you're going to now get this out there to the public again. I know you have your dealers, your galleries that you work with. Mm-hmm. Do you ever consider making some of your work G clay? Do you sell them only your original, the pieces that you've done, that you pulled mm-hmm. yourself, and then you manipulated or changed with paint?
I do
or
not.
Or what? And what's the difference in them?
I do not do G clays. Generally, every maybe once or twice a year, I will do a small addition. I'll work small, number one, mm-hmm. usually 15 by 20. And that will be a small addition, maybe 10 to 15 pieces of work. And that will be a varied addition. And, okay. and I make that available. I'll put it on social media and let people know that those are available. And they don't, my galleries, they have access to them as well. Or, mm-hmm. You can purchase them from the website. But I learned how to addition because I believe that you're supposed to know everything that you can know.
Yes.
So I know how to addition, but I'm not really an additioner. So I'll do varied additions when I have to do an addition. But I can't addition.
Okay.
I just prefer varied additions.
The varied additions.
Mm-hmm.
Very good. And a G clay, of course, is a process that some of the beginning artists will use to get themselves
established. Yeah, and it's not for me, mm-hmm. for my work, and I'm not opposed to it. I would, if it were me as an emerging artist, I would probably limit the number of giclées that I did.
Mm-hmm.
When I put a piece of work out there, I always try and keep my collectors in mind. That's very important to me because, mm-hmm. They have me in their collection and I want to be able to, protect the investment that they've made. So I don't do, once I do a piece, that's it.
Right. And let's explain to our participants today on this entrepreneurship, the difference in a G clay and your regular work.
Yes. So there are reproductions and then there's prints. So when you talk about G clays, your work is being, kind of mass produced, mm-hmm. From a printer. Whereas, using archival papers and, different inks that way. The prints that I make are hand-pulled prints. Each impression, like I said, is a unique impression. And those are all individually hand-done. So that's the difference between the two. So all of my work is hand-pulled.
And it makes a difference in how you can price that work.
It makes an absolute difference in how you can price that work. And when you have a million out there, they're not going to be as valuable as mm-hmm. having, say, 5 mm-hmm. or 10.
Of course.
And versus having 200.
Yeah, a reproduction will allow you to do a lot more of one piece, where, as you said, each print that you pull is an original piece. And that's a greater value to a collector.
Yes.
And depending on where an artist is in his or her stage, they may start with a few of those G clays. But then they'll move on. So what about in the future? What are some of your works you're going to do?
Wow. So in terms of the future, really stay in the studio and work. It's funny because people are like, so what's your hobby? I'm like, art. And they're like, when you take a break, you read about art, you do art. And I'm like, I know. But really just get in the studio and continue to work. I'm also started the Black Box Press Foundation.
Okay.
So I will be working towards that. Right now we have the Art as Activism Grant. We have our first two winners that were selected. And we will be doing our second round of artists in June.
Will you explain to us about that grant?
The Artist Activism Grant, we started the foundation around the time that George Floyd was murdered. And I was speaking with my son about it and we had a conversation and he actually posed for me for that picture and mm-hmm. kind of helped me in the studio to create the piece. And so we decided that, he wanted to make giclées
Okay.
Of that particular print and donate 100% of the funds to charity. And okay. So in looking at charities that we could donate to, we weren't really finding what we were looking for. So I was like, you know what, let's be that change that we want to see. And so we decided to set up a fund for artists who are creating work that talks about social and political change. Okay. And so there are $5,000 grants for each artist.
Great.
We choose 4 per year.
Okay.
And it's a unrestricted grant. And the artist partners with an organization to create an exhibition. And so we're trying to help artists to be able to really get their voices out there and get their voices heard. And so it's called the Art as Activism Fund with Black Box Press Foundation. Mm-hmm. And you can get more information on that at, from our website, blackboxpressfoundation.org. And so we're really excited about that. And so we're hoping our next step is to actually start a residency for printmakers.
Wonderful.
And so I've been, a few people have actually asked me over the years, they're like, you collect a lot of equipment. So this has been in the back of my mind for a while. So I've been collecting equipment, you know, here and there, presses, to set up a residency for artists, for printmakers here in Texas.
That's wonderful.
So excited.
So this is an opportunity to give back.
Yes, it's an opportunity to give back. You know, as an artist, I look back and I had wonderful support. There were other support areas that I wish I had, you know, been able to, if I had had a hand, say, funds to create an exhibition or a body of work, but, you know, that wasn't really ready for, available for me, or finding a particular type of venue to really get me out there in other states. And I was like, you know what, if I can do that for an artist, if I can reach back and grab an artist and help them, propel them, I'm all for it.
I think that's very admirable. And thank you. I'm sure that a lot of the artists are glad to hear that and will go to Black Box to find out more about it.
Awesome.
So just a little bit more about your work before we go to some questions. I know that you have an exhibit, a beautiful exhibit right now that's about to end in Beaumont.
Yes.
But you also have another exhibit that I'd like to hear about. Tell me a little bit about Hollywood.
Hollywood experience. I was contacted a couple of years ago in reference to the photograph. Stage director reached out to me and wanted to know if I would be interested in showing some of my work on the set of the movie. And I was like, of course, you know, Issa Rae, yes. And all, you know, and the story was just amazing. Anyway, so I agreed, and it was so incredible. I went to the theater by myself, thank goodness, because I think I cried like a baby, because it was like so amazing to see my work, you know, to just kind of sit there and be like, okay, you worked really hard and, you know, this is what happens, you know? So it was really nice to see that, even just for, I mean, just like your work is on the screen. It's like some of your favorite actors and actresses are walking by your work and looking at your work, and you're just like, oh my God, that's me. So it was really incredible, an incredible experience.
Wow, that's all I can say right now. And you said the photograph.
Yes.
Someone saw the work.
Well, the director, from my understanding, she's seen my work before, and she requested, you know, to see if they could, you know, reach out to me. So that was amazing. I was like, wow, someone that's looking at my work.
Yeah. So in this little short time, we've taken you from the beginning of your work, mm-hmm. and your desire, knowing that you wanted to be an artist, mm-hmm. to a point where you are being called about your work and even asked to have it to be a part of a play or a movie, part of the backdrop, part of the surroundings. And so this has to make you feel really good about the journey so far. What would you say to the young entrepreneur out there that wants to move a career?
I want to encourage young artists to, when I say, I want to encourage artists to, I deal in the impossible. And I believe in figuring out how to make the impossible possible. And so I encourage artists to do that. If it's your dream, figure out how to make it happen. It may not happen in the traditional way, but that's okay. It can happen the way you need it to happen. So if you want to be an artist, if you have a dream of, you know, being, you know, a musician, visual artist, a performing artist, you can do it. You just have to set your own path.
Delita, this has been wonderful. I so enjoyed talking with you. And I want to thank all of you who've come along this journey with us today. I want to thank the sponsors. I want to thank the Community Artists Collective board members and our executive director, Michelle Barnes. I can't forget Miles, our exhibition coordinator. It's all been really wonderful to be a part of this. And I want to encourage you to go to the www.thecollective.org, and you can actually share, continue sharing Delita's discussion today. You can also, there'll be a special production as well there. And we just look forward to your continued relationship with the Community Artists Collective, and certainly with our artist. I hear she's got some great things coming, and we're now ready to move to another part of this program, which carries us on. Thank you.
Thank you.